Thank you for joining us today. We trust that you will be motivated, challenged, and inspired by this week's message. Let's join Mike now.
So we're going to continue in this series, and what I'm really trying to do is help you better navigate this journey called life. Last week I shared that God accepted us the way we are so we could become what he expected us to be. He has great expectations of us. And he came not only to give us a better future, but also to show us a better present. Last week I shared and used a cassette player to illustrate the message as my prop to show you that we need to fast forward rather than rewind. This week, I thought I'd try something different, so I just got to put this down for a second. I had a T-shirt made just to reinforce the FFWD. And if you want one, you can buy one at Resources afterwards. We can order it for you. It might be a good talking point. You know, someone goes, what's FFWD? What's Hello Future? Great. So our key verse is Philippians 3 and verse 13, where the Apostle Paul said, I am still not all I should be, but I'm focusing all my energies on this one thing, forgetting the past and looking forward to what lies ahead. In other words, he was committed to fast forward in his future, not rewinding his past. We covered the first key last week too, which was understand that the way we deal with our past will shape the way we feel about our future. We talked about not getting stuck on pause and how we need to stop pushing rewind and start pressing play so that we can fast forward to our future. Because if we want to unlock our tomorrow, we've got to make sure that we're not locked in our yesterday. We need to trust in tomorrow more than we believe in yesterday. And we have to make sure our future is more prominent than our past by making our past less prominent than our future. You know, we can make our future more powerful if we make our past less prominent. So let's look at the next key to fast forward in our future. FFWD2, we'll call it. Realize to get to where you need to be, we need to think beyond where we are. To get to where we need to be, we need to think beyond where we are. Genesis 13 and 14 says, after Lot separated from him, God said to Abram, open your eyes and look around. Look north, south, east, and west. Everything you see, the whole land spread out before you, I will give to you and your children forever. I'll make your descendants like dust. Counting your descendants would be as impossible as counting the dust on the earth. So on your feet and move it. Walk through the country, its length and breadth. I'm giving it all to you. What a great promise. You have to understand a little bit of context around this story. So Lot had just separated from Abram. And it wasn't without its challenges. See, these guys were actually at one point quite close. But the problem is, as things progress, as more people get added, as more riches get added, as more livestock gets added, as more resources get added, you know, tension and stress can come. And they started to fall out. So Lot's guys started to fall out with Abram. And so they decided that they would part their ways. And I think God was trying to show us something here. Because we need to understand that when we're in similar circumstances where we are having to part company with something or someone, that this is what we need to remember. Don't look at what you've lost. Look at all you're about to gain. How many of us kind of get so focused on what we've lost that we're missing out on what we're about to gain? So much ahead of us. There's so much to focus on. We can't afford to waste our time looking back all the time, looking back to our past, going over old ground. We're using energy that we need for our future. We can't use our energy in our past because we need every bit of energy that we've got for our future. So we need to make sure that we look beyond our past and focus on our future, because often this is what we do. We have our back to the future. It's not just the title of a great film. But this is what we do. Because if you think about it, if you're looking back to your past, you've got your back to the future. Because all you're doing is looking back all the time. Well, how do you know where you're going to go? Can you imagine walking down? I don't even want to try it along this stage. There's too many places I can fall off. But can you imagine walking along? So not even kind of looking down like I'm going to try and do now because I don't want to fall off the stage or go into Chris's drums. But, you know, if you're walking back, you can't see where you're going because you're still focused. You see everything in your past, absolutely fine, but your future. That's what we do. There's only one direction you can be looking in if you've got your back to the future. And as I've shared so poignantly a couple of times already, is we've got to get our behind out of rewind. We got to get our behind. Just turn lovingly to the person you're sat next to and say, you need to get your behind out of rewind. Oh. You really know how much the person next to you loves you by their reaction. Now turn to them and say, I do love you, and I was saying it in love. Just to make them feel okay. It's love day today. It's Valentine's Day. The Apostle Paul said, I've got my behind out of rewind. I know you're thinking, where's that in the Bible? Listen to it. Forgetting what lies behind and looking forward to what lies ahead. If he was saying that now, he'd say, look, I've got my behind out of rewind. And there's the key right there. It's the direction that we're looking in that determines what we're focused on. It's the direction that we're looking in that determines what we're focused on. Because what we see determines what we be. It determines everything. It determines where we go, what we do, how we do it, and who we do it with. Yeah. It determines where we spend time at, who we spend time with, and what we spend time doing. And maybe that's a challenge. Maybe you're spending too much time with people in your past and not enough time with people in your present. They're going to help you get to your future. Now, you can do that without actually spending physical time with people in your past. It's just that you're giving them headspace. Oh, Pastor, you're challenging me now. We all do it. There are people that feature in our minds from our past, and they're still too prominent. Because maybe we're missing the good side. And it's amazing how we can forget all the bad things and only see the grass as green. But we know that it wasn't always green. We need to make sure that we're using our time wisely and our minds wisely. We need to make sure that we start thinking about more about who we are and whose we are rather than where we are or what we are. I want to remind you today, we are children of the Most High God. We're heirs of Christ. We have a great, great future ahead of us. And you know, we ought to be happy about that. In fact, that ought to get your hands clapping in, your mouths moving in. Because you know what that does? It puts into perspective the position we might find ourselves in and the place we might find ourselves at. Where are you at today? What position are you in? See, our godly prospects change human perspective. Our godly prospects change human perspective. We can have a perspective about our lives right now. But what we need to do is say, does that line up with the fact that I'm an heir of Christ and a child of God? It doesn't matter what people say. What matters is what God says. And if God says, I'm an heir of Christ, and he says I'm a child of his, and I'm actually a friend of God, then it doesn't matter what other people might say that might contradict that. Our godly prospects change human perspective. In fact, that's what we need to do. Put our present position into future perspective. Think about it. Where are you heading? What has God promised in your future? Put your present position into perspective in line with that. Not with past problems. That's what we often do. We put our present position and we align it with past problems. No, we have to realign it with future perspective. What did God say? Okay, that's what I'm aligning to. Because reality is we're not always in a good place. Sometimes we don't quite know how we got there. And then consequently, we don't know how to move on. We don't know how to get out of the mess that we've got in. But if we allow whose we are to remind us who we are, it won't be long before it affects where we are and what we are. And in the process, we'll become all we would be, could be, and should be. I think that God stops us in our tracks. FFWD. And says, okay, reality check. I want you to FFWD. God's singing that to us some days. I want you to FFWD. Fast forward into your future. He's got a much better voice than mine. Right now, God is prompting us to see where we could be and what we should be so that we will be. Read a quote last night. I can't remember exactly how it went. And I will pull it out to use one Sunday, but the essence of it was great. That some people, some believers, so focused on heaven that they waste earth. We got to understand that God's given us a future on earth, not just a future in heaven. That he actually sent Jesus to show us how to live on earth. If everything was about heaven, then Jesus wouldn't have shown us through parable after parable about how to live better on earth. Because think about it. If everything was about heaven, he wouldn't have spent so much time, nor would the Apostle Paul done the same thing, to show us how to get on with each other. Because in heaven, we will get on with each other. In heaven, we won't have a problem with anybody. Everybody will be perfect in heaven. Now, I know you can't imagine that. You can't imagine that right now about the person you're sat next to. And you can't imagine that about yourself. But in heaven, we're all just going to be perfect. But Jesus said, until you get there, I want to give you a better life on earth so that actually you can get on with each other. Because life is a challenge. And people are a challenge. And we are a challenge. And it's making it all work. And Jesus says, if you take what I've taught you and the guys that I've sent, like the Apostle Paul, who have been great mentors for you, then you will be able to make your life better right now and your future better. Yes, amen. See, we need to understand the who in you defines a do in you. The verse we read earlier says, open your eyes, look around, everything you see, I will give you. We need eyes wide open to the opportunities that are around us. Because right now, opportunities are staring you right in the face. Opportunities to do all sorts of things with your life. Opportunities to build God's house. Because everything that we do comes back to building his house. But there are opportunities in your career in order to be able to build his house. There are opportunities for finance to help build his house. There are opportunities for you to get more involved in the house so that we can build this and develop this and reach more people. There are opportunities that God has already set up for this week for you, people that are going to come into your life that you can share about this church. They're staring you in the face. You've just got to see them. See, possibility is inevitably seen through the eyes of opportunity. If we don't see opportunity, we won't see possibility. The key is what you see. You see? What we get is invariably determined by what we see. So if we want something different, we have to see something different. The way we view something determines the way we do something. Said in the verse that we read, look around. In other words, what are you looking at? And what are you looking for? And these two, even though they kind of work and affect each other, they're quite different. Because what we're looking at often impacts what we're looking for. If we're looking at the negative, we won't be looking for the positive. And we need to be people who recognize there's a positive in every negative. We just have to look for it. How hard do you try? How far do you look? I'm sure we have these conversations. I'm sure you have these conversations like I do. And often we'll say to each other, I can't find whatever it is we're looking for. And I say to Lois, so how hard have you looked? And invariably, we'll find it. It does work the other way as well. In fact, probably works the other way more often than that way, if I'm being honest. And it's Valentine's Day, so I'm just going to pour out the love. And but you know, we have those conversations. We didn't look hard enough. We didn't find it because we weren't looking in the right place. So how hard do we try and how far do we look? It says look north, south, east and west. And sometimes God's saying, hey, just look in every direction. Don't think, don't assume that it's over there when actually it's over here. Because sometimes when our plans have gone south, we need to go west. Young man. We'll stop there. When we're talking about our future, the question we have to ask is, how far can we see beyond our present and our past? Some people can't see beyond the end of their nose. They can't picture what they can become because all they can see is where they are or how they were. We've got to all become more visionary. I know some people have the gift of being visionary and some people don't. But here's the thing. What I've found is that people who don't have that gift kind of go, well, it's okay because I don't have that gift, I don't have to be visionary. I think we all have to develop that visionary lifestyle so that we can see what God has called us to. So that we'll always see that something's possible despite how it looks right now. You know, we've done a lot to our house. And how it was compared to how it is, two different things. And you know, I remember when we first got it, there were people around us going, can't quite see what you're going to do with this. They could just see this old house, and it was a 1960s house, and it looked like 1960s. It hadn't been touched since the 1960s, and we wanted to completely transform it into what it should look like nowadays and be a contemporary place. But it's amazing how it all changed, and people go, ah, now I get it. Now I see what you were saying back then, and that's what we've got to do. We've got to see our lives as they will be, not as they are. So we've got to develop the art of purposely looking at how something can become, not how it is. Looking forwards, not backwards. Looking to the future, not the past. Looking at what will be, not what is or what was. So that we'll see the future, past where we've been and beyond where we are. I love Colossians 3 in the Message. It says, don't shuffle along. Eyes to the ground, absorbed with the things right in front of you. Look up. Anybody watch Car Crash Britain? And on Car Crash Britain, there was a cyclist going along, and he had his head down, and he went smack into the back of a car that had stopped because he wasn't looking forward. He was looking down. He was shuffling along. Going at quite a pace, shuffling along. Not for long. Don't be so absorbed with the things right in front of you. Look up and be alert to what is going on around Christ. That's where the action is. See things from his perspective. I love it. Stop shuffling and start seeing. Look up. It's really easy to get so absorbed with what's going on around us that we miss what's going on ahead of us. Things crowd in, and we get absorbed by things that crowd in. You know, my list of DIY jobs is growing because I can't keep up with what needs to be done, and that's not even including future jobs that I would like to start. So we now have jobs that, you know, needed to be finished from the past, but now things that were done 9 years ago now need redoing. So my list is just going like this. And some days I just go, oh, I can't take it. And then you just have to go, do you know what? Look up. Don't get down. Don't let that depress you. Don't let it put you into a place where you say, no, I can't do it. Just look up. Take one thing at a time. Take a step towards your future. How many of you like me that you can feel overcrowded, overwhelmed with things, and you're like, ugh. And then when you put things into perspective, just kind of go, okay, one day at a time. You know, so things won't get done by tomorrow, but that's fine. There are more important things with life than having to do some of those things. So we need to start looking up, not looking down. The Amplified Version says, set your minds and keep them set on what is above. We have to have our minds set, we have to set our minds, not have our minds set. The problem is, all too often, we have our minds set. Our mind is made up, and that is that. Ever met someone that you can't change their mind? I mean, I might be talking about you right now, but we've all met people. I'm sure you can think of people. And you know, they have a mindset about it. You ain't going to change it. It's like they are going down that road despite what you think, despite your opinion, despite how, well you try to convince them. You might be a very convincing person, but you just can't convince them. That's because they've got a mindset. And that's the problem. When our mind is set, it creates a mindset. And a mindset causes us to be inflexible. It causes us to be stubborn. It causes us to be rigid. It causes us to be unwilling to change. And as we get older, these things creep in even more. You know, the problem is we miss out and we settle for second best because our mind is set, rather than striving for first place. We were never created for second best. Because with God, only the best will do. We need to remember that sometimes. He's not called us to a second-hand life. He said we are the head and not the tail. We should be at the front, not at the back. We were created for the best, by the best, and the best is yet to come. And here's the thing. The best is still in our future, not in our past. How many people, you know, get to that place and they just believe that all the best has already happened? You know, we can't believe for anything more because, wow, I've had a blessed life and, wow, I did all the great things I want. I hope I never get to a place that however blessed I've been, I don't believe for more blessing. Because I tell you what, blessing doesn't come with limits. Blessing doesn't, you know, God don't say, well, here we go. There's your quota. And when you get to 70, there's no more blessings. So you just go downhill. You know, the rest is downhill. No, we're going up, 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 and away. The future is still full of promise. What does he want you to do? Not what you can't do, but what you can do through Christ. Today you need to get the sledgehammer out and break that thing apart and reset it in the right direction. Don't be so set in your ways. Just fast forward and not rewind. Let's keep pressing on. Let's keep moving up because the best is yet to come. Our best days are still ahead of us. Our best times have not yet been. They are still in our future. And I'm excited about that.
We hope you have enjoyed today's message. To download further resources, click on the resources icon. If this message has impacted your life, we would love to hear from you. So don't forget to join us next week for another inspiring message.